of the notable characteristics about longleaf is the bark. Longleaf, as a fire-adapted species, has evolved with this really thick bark that makes it tolerate fire really well. You can kill longleaf with fire, but it is adapted to, again, regular intervals of fire. And so you can see the bark on this longleaf is really thick. This tree was actually in a prescribed fire about a year ago, so you can still see the char on the bark, but you can also see how thick this bark is and how it is protects it. And so you can see underneath, if you flake off just a little bit of the bark, you can see that just below that area that's charred, it is the grayish brown color that you think about of a regular trunk of longleaf. It may burn this outer bark, but it has this really thick bark, so it protects, you know, the cambium, it protects the inner part of the tree. Another one of the great fire adaptations that longleaf has is its grass stage. So when a longleaf is in the grass stage, it looks just like it sounds, like a tuft of grass. So it has these long needles. This tree is actually just out of the grass stage. It's starting to actually get elongated, have some height growth on it, but they have these long needles. And these long needles, as again, because they're a fire adapted species, as fire comes across the landscape, these outer needles will burn, but they'll protect the bud that is actually deep here inside. You'll see it, it's white, deep here inside these needles. And so what happens is again, longleaf is adapted to kind of a mosaic of fire. And these were not like the terrible fires you might think about out west. They're more kind of a low fire across burning the grasses as they go across the landscape. And so what would happen is these outer needles will burn, but that protects the bud that's deep inside them. So when we look at identifying southern pines, and we talk about identifying longleaf, this is what a longleaf branch looks like. You can see it's much thicker than the loblolly branches we looked at before. You can actually see it has sort of a scaly bark on the newer growth and has this tuft of needles at the end. This is very characteristic of longleaf. If you look up into the crowns of longleaf and you see, again, they have these thicker branches with these tufts of needles at the end that sometimes people liken to looking like a bowling ball at the end of the branches. You can also tell the difference in the growth, years of growth, where these nodes of where this was a flush of the prior year and then this was the year after. So you can see like this was 1 year's growth and this was the next year's growth. It'll then put on growth from here and you'll be able to tell. So you can kind of age longleaf and to some extent, especially when they're young, by their flushes of growth. One of the most notable features about longleaf are the really large cones. People usually, are able to identify longleaf by the cones. They are really large. They're the biggest of the southern pines. Again, they have, you can see the seed actually in there. They have a small winged seed inside that actually has the seed on the end, small wing, and so that's how the seed actually travels, is it blows, falls, the cones open, the seeds fall out, and then they blow with the wind. Longleaf, a lot of times, they do not produce cones as early as a lot of the other southern pines, and they don't produce as many seed as the other southern pines. So you need a lot more trees per acre if you're looking at natural regeneration. Another thing, though, about them is longleaf a lot of times does not produce cones at heavier stocking levels. So if there's a lot of trees to the acre out there, or if your basal area is really high, you're not as likely to have cones. And if you do have cones, there's a good chance that the seed that might be produced in those cones would not be fertile. So a lot of times what the recommendation is thinning down to about 40 square feet of basal area, somewhere in there, and then that way you can actually start to get more cone production. So here you can kind of see the difference in branching shape and size of longleaf, the one on the bottom, and you can see it's much thicker than the loblolly, which is here on top. And you can also see how those needles run all the way down on that new growth on the loblolly. The loblolly needles are also much shorter than the longleaf, where the longleaf is more kind of in a tuft at the end that people sometimes, you know, liken to looking like a bowling ball at the end. We just that very rounded shape. Also, the stems or the branches are very scaly on longleaf, where they're a little bit smoother with the loblolly. And then there's a definite difference in the cones, where you have the bigger cones of the longleaf and the smaller, more spiky cones of the loblolly. So one thing to note when you're thinking about pine straw and pine straw value is looking at the difference in these needles. You can see that the longleaf needles are very glossy. They're very thick if you were to feel of them. They are in bundles of three, just like loblolly is, but because longleaf is a fire-adapted species, it has very thick, kind of more waxy needles. And you can see they're very stiff. This is opposed to the loblolly, which are a little thinner. They're not as shiny and green. And what happens is again, because this is a fire-adapted species, they are more waxy, and so they hold up more in the landscape. If you're using them as pine straw, they don't deteriorate as quickly as the thinner loblolly needles. The longleaf needles also tend to turn a nice golden color as they age, where the loblolly sometimes can turn a little bit more gray, more ashy color. So from an aesthetic standpoint, the nice golden color of the longleaf really contrasts well with the greens of grasses and other plants that you might have in your landscape.